Hi, welcome to my workshop. My name is Doug Sinning, and I'm a professional musician, actor, instructor, and the founder of MyMusicExpert.com. I'm a Berklee College of Music graduate where I studied songwriting and composition, music education, and music synthesis, you know, using synthesizers and MIDI, and computers. My principal instrument at Berklee was voice, where I studied privately with the once chair of the vocal department, Jan Shapiro. I've taught private music lessons in voice, piano, songwriting, music theory, etc. for over 23 years, and the last exclusively 4 years online through my online company, MyMusicExpert.com. Today, we're going to be talking about musical theater auditioning techniques. I've been a musical director for numerous shows throughout the years at both the community, college, and professional theater levels. And I'm here today to give you some advice and guidance when auditioning for musical theater. If you would like to join this event, the room is open. And it's very easy to join the event. Just go to Google+, search for My Music Expert, the page, and you'll find the event listed there. If you join that you're going to the event, I'll see you pop up there and I'll invite you to the room. You can come in and talk with me, ask me questions, and even if you don't want to be on camera, that's fine. You can actually chat by typing and all sorts of stuff. So come on in, join the fun, and learn something in the process. The most common question that I hear from auditioning is, what is the musical director looking for? What do they want? I'll be that. Whatever they want, I'll be that. That's the wrong answer. Instead, you should be yourself. Just be you. Open, honest, and clay, ready to be molded. Don't change your hair color, or wear platform shoes, or wear a costume to audition in. Just be yourself, pure and simple, ready to be molded by direction. I had seen this so many times, people coming to auditions and dressing up, wearing wigs, wearing platform shoes because they felt inadequate with the, you know, oh, they want a leading man, so I need to be taller. You know, don't do any of that. Be yourself, okay? The first thing that auditioners usually fixate on is parts. You know, what are the parts in the show? And how can I be a part of that? You know, what's available, and what is the age, what is the gender specific information, and stuff like that. Don't worry about that. Think more about singing a song and doing your best instead of trying to fit into some sort of physical role. I see that we have an attendee that joined us. Jonah, thank you for coming.
Yep.
You have a song prepared for us today?
Yeah. Our Love Is Here to Stay.
Excellent. So you got like a 32 bars or something you can sing for me?
Yeah.
Okay, why don't we go ahead and have you sing a little bit of that, and then we'll go forward with the workshop. Go ahead, take it away.
I'd like to dedicate this one to my wife, wherever she is. It's very clear. Our love is here to stay, not for a year, but ever and a day. The radio and the telephone and the movies that we know may just be passing fancies, and in time may go. But, oh my dear, our love is here to stay. not for a year, ever and a day.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead and cut you off.
They crumble, Gibraltar, and stumble. They're only made of clay. But our love is here to stay.
Okay, go ahead and stop for me.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Just had an error. I don't know what that's going to come out and look like on the group feed here, but I got kicked off and came back in. That was kind of strange. Okay, thank you very much for that audition. I did take some notes, and we will go over them together. If you would, go ahead and mute your mic, and we'll go ahead and continue the workshop here. So, before I get into it, let me explain how I do my audition grading and how it works. There are all these categories that I grade on, which we'll go over shortly, but each category gets a grade from like 1 to 5. 1 is not recommendable, 2 is needs work, 3 is average, 4 is above average, 5 is excellent. And all these scores are added together to give a final total. If more than one person ends up with the same score, then I look at specific things that are needed more than others for a specific role to make that final decision. So let's say that 3 people get a score of 48, and you're one of them. If you only had 1 more point, a 49, you would be chosen over the other 2 people. Likewise, if you're a 47, you're out. So you can see just one small thing can mean you don't get the part, at least in the way that I grade an audition. I'm very analytical in my auditioning. So with that in mind, let's look at the things that I look for during an audition in no specific order. Number 1, pitch and intonation. Obviously, can you sing? Can you sing on key? What's a key? A key is a tonal center, okay? So, for example, Mary had a little lamb, little lamb, little lamb. That's one key, but if we raise the key higher, Mary had a little lamb, little lamb, little lamb. So that's a second key. So the different keys are different pitches, different tonal centers. Some are higher, some are lower. So the first grade is, can you sing on pitch? And Jonah, you just did an audition for me. You were having some pitch issues. You were a little flat here and there. So that's something that you need to work on in matching pitch. Something that I would recommend for you to do with your voice teacher is to work on solfege. That's ear training, and that would actually train your ear, which is actually your brain, but we call it the ear because we sense it in the ear, to hear the pitches inside your mind, and then you're able to actually match them with your voice. So matching pitch is literally about listening. It's more about listening than singing. The second thing that I grade on is breath control and how much breath you have. Well, if you are going to sing, you have to have breath. How good is your breath support? Are you breathing in the phrases? In your performance, were there any extended, exciting phrases that shows off that you have the power of your breath support, you know? You can do like, Mary had a little lamb, little lamb, little lamb. Mary had a little lamb whose fleece was white as snow. So you can see I didn't breathe at all there, all right? Or did you go, Mary had a little lamb, little lamb, little lamb. Mary had a little lamb whose fleece was white as snow, which is the worst thing is if you breathe in the middle of a sentence. That's cutting the phrase apart, and you're not supposed to do that. Phrases, by the way, are sentences or musical thoughts. So if you were talking to somebody like I am talking now, unless you're Captain Kirk from the Starship Enterprise, you are not going to stutter like this and talk, okay? You're going to talk in a phrase that's smooth and connected and has a logical ending, and then you breathe. Okay, same thing in music. When you're singing, you want to have that phrasing going on. So I look for breath. Diction. Can I understand what you're saying? There are so many auditioners that come in, and they sound good, but I can't understand a word they're saying. Wah, 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 wah. Stop. Can we start over again and pronunciate for me?
Okay, I'll do the movements.
And they're like talking back to me. I'm like, huh? And they're mumbling. And I'm like, mumbling. I write it down, you know, mumbling. Communication problems. So then they sing it again, and I hear wah, 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 and they didn't make a change, okay? And if they didn't make a change, that means they're not very directable. I write that down. You see how things, they start to snowball, domino effect. Interpretation. Interpretation is the emotion of the song. How are you interpreting the song? What's the phrasing? What's the dynamics? What's the expression? So you could sing, Mary had a little lamb, which is very mechanical and scary to listen to that tone, okay? But you could also sing, Mary had a little lamb, and put like all this, this desire into it, this longing, okay? So you change the way the song sounds just by interpreting it. You can sing the same, you know, it's like when you're talking, you can say, you're really good, or you're really good, or you're really good, or you're really good. You know, they all have different meaning, but you're saying the same thing, right? All right, stage presence. Stage presence is so important when you are auditioning. It's energy, okay? Don't mistake energy, though, for crazy, bold, out-of-control movements, okay? Stand quietly still on stage, and you can still command the stage just by your energy. It's about the eyes. It's about the smile or lack of, depending on the song that you're singing. It's about eye connection. It's about visualization, imagining the scene before you. It's acting, okay? Stage presence. It's all about energy. You don't have to jump around like a jackrabbit, okay, to have energy. It can be completely still and completely silent and still command the stage. Remember that. Sight singing. Yes, I make my auditioners read music during the audition. This is very important. It shows that you're serious about your craft and that you're studying. It shows me that you're also able to read music, which means I don't have to babysit you. I don't have to sit there and play every single note out for you on the piano, because you can read the notes and you can hear it in your head and sing it, okay? So if you have those skills, you get more points in your score, okay? Reading music saves time when directing a musical. I don't have to spend the time teaching you your part. You just read it. You see what I'm saying? This is a valuable skill. Let's talk a little bit about that. Not only in musical auditions, but auditions for, let's say, recording studios. Recording studios have studio musicians that come in. They get paid by the hour, really good money. And if you go in, if you're lucky enough to get a studio session, and you go in and you sight sing the chart that they give you. Let's say we're recording a commercial for the new water park that's opening, right? And you're singing this chart that they give you, and you sight read it, As soon as that's over, they're going to go, what was your name and number again? And they're going to put you in the front, and you're going to get called again. And they're going to rely on you because, again, they don't have to babysit you. And in the studio, as well as on the stage, time is money, okay? So if you read, you're get big points. So work on your reading skills. If you don't know how to read music, have somebody teach you. All right. Harmony. I have had so many people, I'm thinking of specific auditions right now, that people that have auditioned for me, they were exactly perfect for the part. The right gender, the right height, the right hair color, the right voice, amazing soloist. But they could not sing harmony if their life depended on it. They would immediately go off key. And the reason for this is because they're a follower. They're not a leader. Harmony is a skill. And the only way to build that skill is to practice it with other people. And one of the easiest ways to practice harmony is in a choir. So if you have the opportunity to sing in a choir setting, do it, because you're going to learn to blend, you're going to learn to sing in harmony and hold your own part, and it will also teach you rhythm skills. Rhythm is important too. So yes, I sing a harmony part to them alone, and they repeat it back, okay? And then I will sing against them, and they have to hold their part while I'm singing my part, all a cappella, no piano. And if they can do that, they're holding their own part. They're a leader, and they can hear the harmonies, and they can blend. And that's a skill. Like I said, amazing people have passed before me and did not get cast only because the part that would be perfect for them had a lot of harmonies in it. It was harmony intensive, and they couldn't do it. And we couldn't have somebody who was perfect for the part, but then sing with other people and sing like, you know, a cat being murdered because they were so lost. Going on, being prepared. Jonah, this was a little bit of you today. I felt like you were not quite prepared, like you threw this together at the last second. You might have found out about this workshop at the last second. That might be the case. But in any event, you need to be prepared. You need to have your sheet music ready for the accompanist. You need to have your recordings ready to go. And you need to know your songs. You need to know the track, if you're singing with a track, and if you're singing with the piano accompaniment, you need to have practiced it and stay together with that accompaniment, whether it be a track or a piano. Sometimes it's better to sing a cappella because you can't find a track to sing with, or the sheet music that you have, you've not been able to practice with a pianist yet. So you don't know what it sounds like. In that case, you might want to consider singing a cappella without any accompaniment. As long as you can hear it in your ear and hold the melody, that'd be okay. That'd be okay. Okay, so something else that I'll do from time to time, depending on the show, is improvisation. Yeah. I'll say, okay, I'm going to play a couple chords here, and I want you to improvise over it. So, Mary Had a Little Lamb. Let's sing Mary Had a Little Lamb. Now change it. Make it different. Change it again. Make it completely different. Change it again. Make it completely different. I'll see how far I can push them. How artistic are they? How directionable are they? And see what they can do. When you're acting or singing in a musical, it's all about choices. And some people are paralyzed, and they're like deers in the headlights, you know, they freeze, and they don't know what to do when it comes to improvisation. So that's an important skill to practice, all right? Take something that you know and just fiddle with it, play with it, make it your own. Don't try to mimic a recording artist. You know, that's where it starts. That's the beginning. Once you know the base of the song and how the song goes, stop listening to the recording artist. Change it. Make it your own. You know, make it yours. Direction. Are they listening? Are they able to make those changes? Sometimes the director will say, that was really loud and happy. Make another choice. What's that mean? Well, like we just said, we expect it to be different. Musically and emotionally, they're testing you. Don't be afraid. Just do it. Okay? Don't be afraid. Just do it. No director wants a dead fish on stage. If you know what I mean, that's the one setting type of back. They only have one type of thing they can do. Have you ever seen an actor in a major motion film that no matter what film they are in, they are always the exact same character, their exact same personality, the same voice, the same mannerisms? It's kind of boring. You kind of get over it on sequel two, right? That's what I'm talking about. One setting. They're not actors. They're just, you know, people that got lucky and they're on stage and Hollywood is full of them. Posture. Don't slump unless it's lending to the interpretation of the song. For example, if you were playing or singing a song that was an old woman, you might want to slouch a little bit, pantomime that you have a cane. You know, and take on the acting and the presence of an old woman or an old man. If not, present your body with confidence and with energy. Again, it's all about energy. Dedication and commitment. If you don't have time to do a show, why are you here? I've actually said that to people because we have these sheets that I'll have them fill out, and one of the sheets is availability. And as they're auditioning, I'm looking at their resume, I'm looking at their headshot, I'm looking at their availability. And I'll see this availability sheet, and it'll be like blocked out, like they have no life, they're completely booked, right? And I'm like, why are you even here? You don't have time to do a show. You know, are you able to drop something off of the schedule? And sometimes they'll say no. And as a director, that means you're wasting my time. And unfortunately, directors remember that. And so the next time you come in, there's going to be this subconscious irritation that happens going, I know this person from somewhere. I've seen them before. I kind of don't like them, but I don't know why. You know, it kind of colors your experience, your relationship, basically, with that director. So if you're going to audition for a show, make sure that you're able to commit to the show in the first place. Jonah's asking a question. You can go ahead and unmute your mic and ask it with your voice. Don't be shy. Okay. Click the button.
Do you advise against singing a song from the play you're auditioning for?
That's a very good question. I'm actually glad you asked that. It actually, unless the director has specifically said to sing something from the show, I would not do it because you're setting yourself up. You know what I'm saying? You want to sing something not from the show, but that is similar in style, if that makes sense. So if you're doing a show that has a lot of, let's say, 50s and 60s bebop R&B type sound, you want to find that type of song to sing. If you're doing something that's more operatic, like Les Miserables, then you want to find something that's more that style of music. You want to keep the same genre or style in mind, but don't do a song from the show unless the director specifically requests it. That would be the guideline that I would follow. Just to stay safe, because if you go in with a song from the show and they don't want it, they're going to go, don't sing this, sing something else. And you're going to be like, I didn't prepare anything else. And they're going to go, next. Okay. Does that answer your question? You have any more?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
No.
Okay.
No.
If you think of another one, just unmute your mic and ask.
All right.
Okay, cool.
Thanks.
Placement. Not only what vocal register you're singing in, like for women, they have the head voice and the chest voice, but more specifically, where in the head are you placing your voice? Is it nasal sounding? Is it rich and open and resonant? Or is it thin and closed and pinched off? This is vocal technique. Now again, acting-wise, interpretation of the song, you might want to do some of those things if it lends itself to the song. Like, for example, again, if we're doing an old woman might not have this rich, open, resonant voice. It might be a little more shallow and thin and pinched off, depending on what song you're singing. So you can interpret the song and change your voice, but make sure that you're making that choice and it's not just your voice. Okay, so again, that takes vocal training. That's technique. The tone and the timbre of your voice, the color, the quality of your voice, that's affected by many things. The projection of your voice. Can I hear you? I have had people come in and sing a song where I couldn't hear them. You know, the piano was louder than they were. You know, dynamics are very important, but you should be heard. Okay, personality. Before and after your song, you need to show your true personality. You need to be you. Don't be fake. Fake equals uncomfortable and non-confident. Okay? Just be yourself. Be you. There is nobody else like you. That's what we want. We want unique people. We don't want fake look-alikes or sound-alikes. We want unique individuals. Always say thank you at the end of your audition. Be courteous to the director and the person or persons that are auditioning you. You're already forging a relationship with this director, whether you realize it or not. And that director will remember your personality and your politeness. It goes a long ways. Nobody wants to work with a diva. And I fired a few before. We've had to let people go. Remember that. Be kind. Be courteous. Appearance. Are you well dressed? Are you dressed appropriately? I've had people come in, you know, I've seen it all throughout the years. I've had people come in just an appropriate dress for an audition. You want to present yourself in a nice appearance. You don't want to show up in holy t-shirts that you've been out gardening in that have holes in them, you know, things like that, right? So then after I grade all of these different aspects that we just talked about, then I have this big box at the bottom of the sheet. It says comments, and I'm always taking notes about all these different things and anything else. Then there's another box that I have on my form that I created that has possible characters, and that's based on the gender, the age, and the range. We will test your range, by the way, during the auditions so that we can see what's the highest note you can sing, what's the lowest note you can sing, so that we know your vocal range in general, and we'll make sure that you can actually do the part. I would like to do a little note, and this is to stage mothers and stage fathers. I'm talking to you now. A stage mother or a stage father is someone who wants to take over the direction process during the child's audition or, heaven forbid, during rehearsals. Stay out of it. You are not helping. In fact, you are probably hurting more than helping. And for goodness sakes, do not try to tell the director what to do or how to run the audition process. That includes giving your child direction during the audition. There is only one director, and it's not you. It's best that you stay out of the room completely while your child is auditioning. I will ask parents to leave on purpose because of this. Oh, she can do so much better. Start it over. She can smile, honey. I've heard it all. Okay? You're not helping. That tells me no, next. Because if I hire this child, I'm hiring that stage mother, and I don't need that stress in my life. N-O, exclamation point, stage mother, next person. It's as simple as that, guys. I'm telling you the truth. Directors abhor that. It really causes a lot of issues and politics. So please just stay out of the room. Be supportive of your child. Absolutely. Be there for them. Take them to the audition. Be there after the audition. But during the audition, stay out of the room. Okay. So, any questions, Jonah? No? Okay. If you think of something, just let me know.
I actually got to go now.
So. Okay, sure. Go ahead. We're almost done anyway. Thanks for coming. Thanks for coming. I hope you enjoyed it.
You too.
Bye-bye. So, let's say you auditioned and you didn't get the part. Let's talk about that for a second. Your job is actually to audition. Getting the part is the cherry on top of the sundae. Your job is to audition. That's how you have to approach the business, okay? It's full of rejection. So you have to approach it with the mentality that your job is to get your auditions together and go out and audition. That's your job. I did a job today. I auditioned. I did a job today. I auditioned. I did a job today. I auditioned. And you just keep going with a smile and happy that you're auditioning. Sometimes you're called into auditions. That's really special when a musical director or a director will call you up on the phone and say, you know, I'm directing this show and I saw you perform in this other show at this theater and I think you'd be really good for this part. Why don't you come on in and audition? Those are really special. You're not always going to get the part, you know, and it can be literally one point off, like we talked about earlier. So don't take it personally. Do not take it personally. Don't get down on yourself. Just keep going, okay? The business, and you can apply this to anything in life, is, you know, 25% talent and 75% perseverance. You know, it really is. It's about showing up. That's all there is to it. You work hard, you create your craft, you create your music, you create your vocal talent and your acting abilities, but that's only 25% of the challenge. 75% is just showing up. And if you're showing up, you're going to get a part. It's going to happen, and then word's going to happen, and your skills are going to improve from that experience, and you're just going to build, and it's going to keep building and building and building and building. But you can't get down on yourself. If you didn't get a part, blow it off. It's okay. So instead of thinking of not getting cast, instead ask yourself, how do I feel about my audition? You know, if you bombed on a specific thing, then you need to work on that specific thing. Seek out an instructor and get to work before your next audition, because 2 weeks before is too late. And I see this all the time. As a vocal teacher, I will have people that will look me up and find me and say, oh yeah, I'm gonna hire you because I got all this time to prepare for this audition. It's 2 weeks away. I'm like, what? It's only 2 weeks away. What song do you have in mind? I don't know. You're going to help me find one. Oh my God. Okay. So, 2 weeks, that's pretty fast. You know, you need to have a battery, you know, a collection of audition songs ready at the get-go that you can just pull out, brush off, and go. So you need to have all that prepared. My vocal students have reams of music. Students that have worked with me for years have multiple three-ring binders full of music. I have them all alphabetize it in order so they can find songs very quickly because they're all in order alphabetically. You know, so you have to be prepared, Boy Scout. So in other words, instead of getting down on yourself, ask yourself, how did you feel about the audition and what did I learn from that experience of auditioning? Okay? Auditioning is a skill in itself, and you can only get better at it by doing it. along with working with a qualified instructor. What if you did get cast? Well, congratulations. Now the real work starts. You just starting. Write this stuff down, because this is good stuff right here. Write this down. Bring a digital recorder. I'm going to say it again. Bring your own personal recording device. I cannot stress that enough. I play parts out one time. That's it. If you missed it, too bad, so sad. Get it from somebody else is what I'll say. Well, they were here the other day. Get it from them. I do not babysit, okay? Bring a recorder. I don't care if it's a big clunky thing on an 8-track. I've never seen that, but I've seen cassette tapes still. That's fine. Bring it. It doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be digital. A lot of y'all have smartphones these days. Well, you can have a digital recorder right on your smartphone. Just pop that baby open and load that app and hit record and place that down. Record your parts. Make them separate files, each song a different file, so that you can find it quickly instead of one long 2-hour recording. Okay. Also, bring a pencil. Not a pen, but a pencil. There's a reason for this. All the music that is rented to do shows is not owned by us, the theater, the director, or the musical director. And it's all printed music, and you cannot use a pen in it. If you use a pen in it, guess what happens? The theater gets charged money, and they have to buy the book. If it's pencil, you write in the book very lightly. Not heavily, but lightly, take your notes in the book, and then before you hand that book back in, you're going to erase all that pencil markings. You have to erase it all, okay? Be responsible. Erase your book before you turn it back in. Be attentive. Take direction. Don't play into the disruptive behavior of other cast members. Be nice to the other cast members, but don't talk while the director is talking. Be attentive. Don't be afraid to express yourself, though, and your ideas to the director, okay? It's awesome that you have ideas. Express yourself. Raise your hand. Give a suggestion. I was thinking this character could do this, that, or the other, or, you know, the director will let you know if they're open to accepting your ideas or not. But don't be afraid to express yourself. But never, ever interrupt a director. And never think that your idea is way better than the director's. The director has spent months preparing in advance before you even start rehearsals. They already have the plan, okay? The plan may not be completely set in stone or cement or concrete, but pretty much the overall picture of what's going on is in their mind and heading that direction. And if they hear an idea from you and it doesn't fit the general direction of the overall thing, they'll say, well, that's a great idea, but it's not going to fit into what we're doing. Just take it at that and let it go. Don't take it personally, okay? If you do get in an argument about your idea better than the director's, guess what? You might not get cast next time, because you're going to be labeled then as a difficult diva type of actor. And directors talk. We talk to each other, okay? Word gets out that you're being difficult during a production, and no one, and I mean no one, wants to work with a prima donna or a diva. And by the way, guys, you don't have to be female to be a prima donna. I've worked with many male prima donnas, trust me. Straight males that are prima donnas, all right? Word gets out. You don't get the part next time. Be professional at all times. That's all it is. Be courteous and professional. I should also mention that I am available for private online Skype music lessons in voice, piano, songwriting, music theory, ear training, solfege, etc. at mymusicexpert.com. We also have other instructors that teach guitar, bass guitar, and flute, and we will be expanding into the other instruments as well. Come on over, take a lesson with me sometime online. You'll have some fun, I guarantee it. We'll laugh, but you will also learn a lot. If you enjoyed my workshop, please, please comment below in the YouTube and share it. Share it with your friends. Post it on Facebook, tweet it out. You know, share. It's fun. So I'll leave it at that. And I wish you a good evening and practice. See you next time. Bye-bye.